Today, we are diving into the fascinating world of cycle syncing and how you can use it to feel your best no matter what time of the month. Ever wonder why you crave carbohydrates more during certain parts of your cycle and other times you'll feel sluggish despite getting enough sleep? It all comes down to the fluctuation of your hormones during your menstrual cycle. By understanding these changes, we can sync our diet and exercise routines to optimize our health and well-being throughout the month. Now, there are two main phases in a woman's cycle, the follicular phase and the luteal phase. Understanding your hormone levels during these two phases is key for cycle syncing. So first up, we have the follicular phase. This phase starts on the first day of your period and it lasts until ovulation. So this is generally around day 1 to 14 of your cycle. Estrogen is the dominant hormone during this phase. During this phase, you have boosted energy levels, a boost in metabolism, and better insulin sensitivity. Okay, so as I just said, your estrogen levels are at their highest during this phase. But what does this mean for our diets and the foods we should be eating? Well, as I also just mentioned, this means you have better insulin sensitivity, which translates to better blood sugar control. This means your body is better able to handle carbohydrates without such drastic swings in your blood sugar. Now, this doesn't mean you should or you have to be eating massive amounts of carbs during this phase. I know a lot of people in my community eat a lower carbohydrate diet, and being in your follicular phase certainly isn't a free pass to go wild. But if you do want to incorporate some more carbohydrates in your diet, and particularly around workouts when they're going to be the most beneficial, now is the time to do so. Now, of course, you always want to be prioritizing protein at all of your meals and making sure you're consuming 30 grams minimum. 30 grams minimum per meal. Healthy fat is also important during this phase and throughout your menstrual cycle for optimal hormone function. So yes, if you choose, all three macronutrients can be consumed during this phase, but the focus should not be on carbohydrates. It really should be on protein and fat. And this is especially true if you already have any pre-existing issues with blood sugar, with insulin, if you're insulin resistant, if you have PCOS or type 2 diabetes. Again, being in this phase is not a free pass to go wild with the carbs. Your blood sugar control will be better during this phase as opposed to the second phase of your cycle, but it still might not be optimal if you already have blood sugar dysregulation. During this phase, you're also going to have fewer cravings, which means intermittent fasting will be easier. Again, this isn't something you have to include in your routine, but if you have been experimenting with it or if you have been interested and wanting to give it a try, this is the time to do so. Moving on to exercise, your follicular phase is when you're going to feel the most energized and when you're going to feel your strongest. Your body is also able to recover quickest during this phase. So you're going to require less rest time between workouts. This is the time to focus on resistance training, lifting heavier weights to build muscle. It's also the time, if you choose, to do more high-intensity workouts. Okay, so that's the first half of our cycle out of the way. We're feeling pretty great. Now we've hit ovulation and we move into the luteal phase. This phase lasts from right after ovulation until your next period starts. And this is when progesterone is the dominant hormone. This phase comes with lower energy, increased cravings, and more water retention. And right off the bat, I'm just gonna say, this phase is a lot less fun than the follicular phase. Insulin sensitivity decreases, blood sugar becomes more variable, and our metabolism actually speeds up. We end up burning about 500 more calories per day, which actually sounds pretty good for weight loss, right? Unfortunately, it's not that simple. This increase in our metabolism makes us feel hungrier. We have more cravings and we have more water retention because of it, especially in the last week leading up to our period. And it's also a double-edged sword because yes, our metabolism has ramped up, but unfortunately our insulin sensitivity has decreased. So now we're here craving sweets, we're here craving carbohydrates, but our body isn't able to manage them as well. When we eat sugar and carbs during this phase of our cycle, we're going to see more drastic rises in our blood sugar than if we ate the exact same foods in the follicular phase. Now, this doesn't mean you have to avoid carbohydrates entirely for the second half of the month. just be a little bit smarter about them. Always make sure you're pairing them with protein and fat. Don't eat them in isolation. And another bonus tip that can make a huge impact that not a lot of people talk about is getting proper sleep. Even just one night of poor sleep has been shown to throw hunger and metabolism hormones out of whack, meaning your blood sugar will be even more all over the place. But if we get proper sleep during this phase, our blood sugar is gonna be easier to control. Maybe not as good as if we got the same amount of sleep in the follicular phase, but better than if we sleep poorly. And one of the most important things here is to make sure you have a consistent bedtime and a consistent wake time, even on weekends. And if this is something you struggle with, the biggest tip I can give you here is to manage your light exposure. And this is easier than you might think. Light and its absence is a key indicator for a circadian rhythm. All you have to do to use light to your advantage is get outside as early as you can in the morning for at least 15 minutes. Getting sunlight exposure first thing in the morning starts a timer for when melatonin, the sleep hormone, will be released later that night. So get outside for at least 15 minutes in the morning, ideally 30 if you have the time. And this needs to be direct sunlight. It can't be through windows. It can't be through your windscreen on your car. It needs to be direct. The second part to this is limiting your light exposure after sunset. And this is tricky because yes, obviously the sun sets, so you don't have that issue. But artificial lights can trick our bodies into thinking it's still daytime. And this can suppress melatonin. The easiest way to combat this is to put on a pair of blue light blocking glasses after sunset. This pair from Bond Charge have been my go-to for the last 4, maybe even 5 or 6 years. And these are my number one recommended brand because they are lab tested. A lot of the cheaper ones you see on Amazon aren't, and they aren't actually blocking the wavelengths of light that need to be blocked. So you're basically wearing them for nothing. Again, this is a really quick fix. Get sunlight exposure in the morning, limit artificial light exposure in the evening, and you're gonna sleep like a baby. I'll put the link to the blue light blocking glasses I wear in the description box down below. Okay, that was a bit of a tangent that I didn't think I was gonna go on, but back to the luteal phase and the impact it has on how we exercise. So like I said earlier, during the luteal phase, our energy level drops. But beyond this, our strength actually decreases as well, and our recovery is a lot slower. Basically, everything during this phase is gonna feel a lot harder. You might have been able to lift X amount of weights the week before, and now you can barely move it. You didn't get weaker, it's just part of your cycle. So now is not the time to go for a 1 rep max or to push yourself in really high intensity workouts. Instead, opt for lower intensity. You can still do resistance training. You might just want to use lighter weights and do more reps. Low intensity cardio is also great during this phase. So walking, swimming, maybe very light jogging, and Pilates and yoga can be good as well. Again, keep in mind that your recovery is going to be slower, so you're going to need more time in between your workouts. Now, before we wrap up, I want to talk to you about the easiest way to track your cycle so you know where you are and you can make the necessary adjustments to cycle sync. The key is to monitor your temperature. Once ovulation happens, your body temperature increases and it stays elevated until menstruation. Once I see my body temperature start to go up, I know exactly how many days I have until my period starts. Now, I use the Oura ring to track my body temperature. This is a sleep tracker that tracks temperature as well, also tracks activity and recovery. But if you're just looking to track your temperature, you can use a thermometer. Take your temperature as soon as you wake up, before you get out of bed, and record it. You can also use apps such as Natural Cycle, that's the one I use. You can input your temperature and you can see on a graph how your temperature is tracking. Natural Cycle actually automatically syncs with Oura, so I don't even have to do anything. All my temperature details sync into the app and I can see exactly where I'm at in my cycle, which makes it really easy to know how I should be eating and how I should be exercising, depending on where I am. I'll put the link to Oura Ring and also the Natural Cycles app in the description box down below. And there you have it. Understanding the hormonal changes during our menstrual cycle and what that means for diet and exercise can help us to get more in sync. Anyways, guys, that's all I have for you today. Let me know in the comment section down below if there are any changes you're gonna make to get more in sync. Let me know down below. I love chatting with you guys in the comment section, and I will see you next time. Bye, guys.